Everyone, today we are going to talk about relational data models. Okay, let's see what we are going to cover in this. First, we are going to talk about what is relational data model. Then we'll talk about how the evolution reached up to the relational data models. I'm not going to talk beyond that because the rest of the topics will be taking care of it. So up to relational data models, the evolution. Then we'll talk about what relational data models have to offer, in which we'll talk about the key terminologies, the properties of a relation, what are the different types of keys and normalization. After that, we'll talk about planning a relational model, how to plan a relational model with one example. After that, when is the right situation to use a data model, which is relational. And eventually we'll talk about some advantages and disadvantages of the data model, relational data model. Okay, so I'll start with the definition of relational data model as given by Agar F. Cord in 1969. It reads something like, the relational data model is an approach to manage data using a structure and a language which is consistent with first order predicate logic. So basically what he's trying to say is to make the sentences or the statements in a language in certain way that they form a structure. Okay, let me try to explain that. Let's try to see what first order predicate logic means first at a higher level. First order predicate logic is a type of logic. I mean, it is derived from mathematics and logics. So this in logics, there is a type of logic or a branch which is called first order predicate logic. According to it, we represent the prepositions or statements into expressions and variables. So if you see the example, a statement Mustang is a car, this is a simple statement talking about some objects. According to first order predicate logic, this statement can be redefined in a way that we identify a variable and then create an expression out of it. So this statement can be read with the help of first order predicate logic as, there exists X such that X is Mustang and X is a car. Here, X is the variable that we invented for representing the statement into the first order logic with the help of a relation or a quantifier, there exists. So the idea behind the first order predicate logic is, use of the first order predicate logic is to make sure that every statement can be defined in terms of some variables and functions. So if we modify the definition, or complete the definition as given by Cord, the relational model is an approach to manage data using a structure and language which is consistent with first order predicate logic, where all the data is represented in terms of tuples and grouped into relations. So this is what Edgar was trying to do at that time. If we talk about the evolution, the very first type of database model that we had was hierarchical database model, in which the data is organized into a tree-like structure. We have got a single root at the top level, and the tree follows with a one-to-many relation. In this kind of data model, each child would have only one parent, but a parent can have multiple children. One basic example of this is the Windows registry. Even today, they use hierarchical database model. There were limitations to this model. So that's why one of the limitations being one-to-many relation. It made the path for network database models, in which many-to-many relations are also possible. A network data model is basically the extension of a hierarchical data model. In it, the data is organized like a graph, which allowed more than one parent for any child. That way, many-to-many relations are also possible. But eventually, there was a shift from storing data in hierarchical or a navigational structure to organizing the data in the form of tables which are related. And that is where the relational database model came into the picture. In relational database model, the data is structured or organized in the form of 2D tables. What are relational databases? A database that is based on the principle of relational model is called as a relational database. A relational database offers a declarative method for specification of the data and the queries. The data is present in the form of relations, and the queries can be issued by the users in the form of SQLs. A few basic examples of different types of relational databases available today are Microsoft SQL Server, Oracle Database, IBM DB2, Postgres SQL, etc. Now we talked about the evolution of the data models to relational data models, but let's see what relational data models have to offer. The very first thing that they offer is the concept of relations. The data is structured in the form of relations, and any kind of query can be answered through those relations. The second thing they offer is a possibility of a distributed database. Before the relational models, it was a challenge to have the hierarchy or the navigation possible with and the data being spread across different machines in a cluster. But with the relational model into the picture, it provided a layer in which the users didn't see how the data was stored eventually, but the database had the capability of having a distributed cluster. Next came the concept of keys. Here we talk about how the data is related to each other with the help of keys. Integrity constraints, two types of integrity constraints, entity and referential. By entity constraints, I mean if in a DB, we specify a certain constraint for an entity, for example, a field is not null, then it is a responsibility of the relational data model to take care of that. At the same time, referential data integrity means, let's say we define a certain primary key in a database, in a table, and that a key or that particular column is referenced in some other table. And if anything happens to that primary key, the same will be reflected into the reference also. So I'll explain about it later. The last one that the last feature that relational model offer is database normalization. Not just the very first step of creation of the database is what done through relational data model, but we can have series of steps of refining the data with the help of data normalization to make sure the data is free of redundancies. Okay, these are the things that are offered by the relational models. Let's talk about the key terminologies that are present in case of a relational data model. A relation is basically a table, or in simple terms, it's table or a set of data elements. Attribute is the property that defines a relation. In simple terms, it is the column header or the field. A domain is a set of possible values which is accepted by that attribute. For example, in case of a Boolean type of attribute, a flag, the possible domain would be a true or a false. Then we talk about a tuple. A tuple is, in simple terms, defined as each row in a relation, each row in a table. A record or a row is called as a tuple. Schema of a relation is the table definition, or in simple terms, it is the combination of the name of the relation and the set of attributes it contains. So number of attributes that a schema contains becomes the degree of that relation. And the number of rows present in a table or a relation becomes the cardinality of the table. So these are the key terminologies that are used in defining a relational data model. Let's take an example. There is a simple table called SDAP, in which there are four attributes or columns: ID, name, age, and location, and some rows and some data is populated for each one of them. Here, the name of the table, that or the table itself represents a relation. Each column represents an attribute, and since there are four columns in this table or relation, the number of or the degree of the table becomes four. Each record or each row represents a tuple, and since there are seven such records in the whole table, the cardinality of the table becomes seven. And if we see in the location column or location attribute, India is one of the possible values which can be put into a location column. So India is an example of a domain. The set of values which we can put into that location column form the domain of that attribute. Next, we are going to talk about the properties of a relation. What properties a relation need to have for it to become a better relational data model. First one is, a table or a relation has a unique name, because a relation can only be present once in a certain relational database. So that is why it is required that it'll be represented by a unique name. Second is, there are no duplicate rows in a relation. No two rows are duplicate or identical. Each row is identified with the help of a primary key, which uniquely identifies it in the whole relation. Columns have atomic entity values. By this, I mean, in a certain column, let's take the example of the SDAP, the country, a person might have traveled to multiple countries, but in a relation, it is required that we don't put multiple entries in a single attribute. We cannot put India, Singapore in that column. I mean, we can put it, but that's not the right thing to do. That will complicate the whole system. Why we need the data or the fields to be atomic is because it simplifies the data manipulation. The fourth property of a relation is, entries from columns are from the same domain based on the data type. The example that I took previously was the country or the location domain attribute. In that, possible values, they are of similar type. And a set of domain, which is predefined, is only capable of filling the values in each row for that attribute. Operations combining different data types are disallowed. If a certain column or attribute is of type Boolean, and if you're trying to apply some string-based operation on that, the database or the model should not allow it. Each attribute in a relation has a distinct name. If we see in the whole database, a relation will be having a unique name. But inside for the column, we can have similar columns in different relations in the same database. But inside the scope of a relation, a column can column name has to be unique. And the last property is, the sequence of columns and rows is insignificant. It is for the hardware layer or the database layer to decide on how to store, how the data is distributed. For the end user, the data can be present anywhere. So there is no sequence that is maintained, and it is of no significance. Moving on, let's talk about all the possible keys that are available or present in a relational database. First of all, let's talk about what keys are. A key is a single column or a set of columns in a table, which is used to sort or identify rows in a table. Different types of keys that we have, and the very first one, primary key, that it is the set of columns or fields which uniquely identify a row in a table. The value of a primary key cannot be null, and it is the only key or column of the table or the relation which is indexed. Second is foreign key. Foreign key defines the relationship between columns in two different relations. The first one would be the primary key. In the other table, in the first table, it will be a primary key. In the second table, it will be the foreign key having a relation with that primary key. And the first one in the first table, it will be indexed as a primary key. Why we need it is because they are designed to ensure consistency. The third one is composite key. Composite key is also a primary key, but it can have one or more columns. A natural key, one basic example of a natural key would be in a telco-based environment, we can have some fields which can uniquely identify a certain record, for example, MS-ISDN or a customer ID or customer number. So these kind of fields which pre-exist in a domain and can be used as the primary keys are called as the natural keys. At the same time, the system itself or the database itself can create some keys which are not existing in the data itself. They are called as surrogate keys. A candidate key is a column or set of columns that can uniquely identify any record. So if you see a difference between a candidate key and a primary key would be, because I mean they are doing the same thing, a candidate key, there can be multiple candidates which can serve as a primary key. And one of those candidates is selected as the primary key of the table. The last one is the compound key, which is consisting of two or more fields that can uniquely describe the row in a table. Now, if you see the candidate key and compound key, they sound similar, but the difference is in the candidate key, one or more columns, if they are used, can be foreign keys. But a compound key is always formed with foreign keys. Any questions in this?
Not able to understand the difference between candidate key and composite key and primary key.
A composite key, a composite key, we don't use a composite key in general. A composite key would be just a way of creating a primary key. Okay, it is a way of creating a primary key in a table. Okay, a single key can be used as a composite key, or multiple keys can be used as composite key. There are two different ways of finding creating a primary key. So if it is a single field, we can straight away call it a primary key. But if it is a combination of multiple fields, that is also used to create a primary key. A composite key is a way in which a primary key can be created. But the type of different keys based on whether they are the foreign keys or not, this thing is taken care in the candidate key. In a certain table, there can be multiple keys which are capable of forming the primary key. Now, selecting one of them or a combination of them would be the decision taken by the modeler to use, which one to use as the primary key. That is the next step. The first one is to identify fields which are capable of finding the primary key. So that is a candidate key. And a candidate key can be a foreign key also. But for a compound key, there are tables in which we are not able to find a single field which is only present in that table, which defines the table, which identifies each row uniquely. So it can be a case that, let's say, if there are there is a table called a course ID, a course table in which we have got course ID and course name. In this, the primary key will be the course ID. Another table, a student roll number and student name. This can be another table in which the student ID can be the primary key. But let's think of a third table in which we are talking about the marks scored by the student for a particular course. In this case, the three columns that are possible are a course ID, a student ID, and the marks. A student can have multiple, can have different courses and can have different marks. So multiple rows are possible. So in this case, any one of them cannot serve as a primary key. So we are dependent on two different foreign keys to create a primary key, which is the combination of the course ID and the student ID. So, but in general, these both are foreign keys of different tables. So that is why a compound key can only be made using foreign keys. A candidate key can be a combination of a foreign key and a non-foreign key, or it can be a local key also.
Okay, so candidate key, by as the name suggests, we can think that these are the keys which can uniquely identify a particular record. But if a modeler selects few fields to create a primary key, that becomes a composite key. And if he selects only one, that becomes a primary key.
That's a primary key. But if all those keys are foreign keys,
that is compound key. Yeah.
Okay, moving on. The last thing, one of the things that relational database models offer is the concept of normalization. Normalization is the process of structuring a relational database to reduce the redundancies and to improve data integrity. The idea is to break down the tables so that more relations can be created and less data is duplicated. Why it is done is it makes the relation or the table free of insert, update, and delete anomalies. So what are these insert, update, and delete anomalies which exist in a database? So think of two tables. One of them is a reference table. The other one is a referencing table. The left one is having two columns, course ID and the course name. Here, the primary key is course ID. And on the right, if we see, we have got a referencing table. The columns in this one are student ID, name, and course ID. This course ID is the foreign key for this table, which is referenced through the reference table course ID field. Now, what is an insert anomaly? Let's try to insert a row into the referencing table with the values student ID 4, name Amit, and course ID 4. The database will throw an exception because since the course ID field in this table is a foreign key and the set of values which are present in the reference table for that particular primary key do not have 4 in it, the system will not allow this insertion. This is called as insert anomaly. Let's talk about update or delete anomaly. Now we're talking about the reference table. Let's try to update the course ID 3, which was having a course name civil, to a different course ID 4 and course name civil. While we are doing it, we can clearly see that this 3 value is not referenced anywhere on the right side. It is not referenced. In this case, the database will allow it, but if we put a value 2, if we try to update the course ID 2 with some other value, it will not be allowed by the database. The database will say, will throw an exception saying that this is not allowed. This particular data is referenced somewhere else in a referencing table. So these are called as update, delete, or insert anomalies that exist in the system, but with the help of normalization, these can be removed. So a lot of ways can be used to remove these anomalies, cascading effect and all. But that one we'll take care in detail later. I mean, not in this topic. Another reason for normalization to be present is to reduce the need for restructuring the data when a new type is introduced in the table. Because the tables or the relations in a relational database through normalization can be split into multiple tables, multiple relations, that they will, it is very much possible that if a new type is to be added, it will not affect the relation at all. But again, that depends on what kind of data we are planning to add. The last thing that the normalization will help in a relational database is to make it more informative. A normalized table would be a combination of multiple tables referenced through different keys. And if we look at the model of the table, it's quite informative. We are able to understand the relation also through different connections. the different types of normalizations that are available today are the one normal form, second normal form, three normal form, and so on. There is DNF also, but I'm not going to talk about them in detail. Next, we're going to move on to planning a data model. In this, we are going to talk about what are the various steps that are involved when we are going to plan a relational data model. These steps are at a higher level. I'll try to explain this with the help of an example. The various steps that are involved are first to define the purpose of the database, then determine the categories of the information that is there, identify the relations, followed by defining those relation types. Once the relation types are identified, we define the various attributes of the field in each relation, each table. Once the attributes are defined, now from those attributes, we decide on what are going to be our primary keys, what are going to be our foreign keys. And eventually, if needed, we can refine the data or normalize it. So let's see it in action. The first step is to define the purpose of the database. In this step, we gather the requirements. We define various objectives. At the same time, we can use sample queries or reports which we want the database to present. These can be useful to identify the requirement of or the purpose of the database. The example would be that I'm taking today is creating a simple database for tracking customers' invoices. This is the requirement. So once the requirement is there, let's go to the next step, in which we will determine the categories of the information. Basically, what we're trying to do is to identify various entities that are present in the database. And those, and we create tables, subject-based tables for each of those entities. If you see the example, for the customer's invoice database, we came up with three different entities, customer, invoice, and product. And these are the very higher level entities that are there. And we understand that these three are not, they have their unique attributes. They might have their unique attributes or they have their own definition. So we ended up creating three subject-based tables, customer, invoices, and products. Next step is to identify the relations, the relation between these subjects, in which we connect the various tables that we have created with the help of relation. So the identified relation in this case are customer can have invoices and invoice may have some products. So these are two relations that we identified as part of the next step. But now let's talk about defining what type of relation it is. By type, I mean, is it a one-to-one relation, one-to-many relation, or many-to-many relation? In this example, we see a customer can have many invoices. So that becomes a one-to-many relation. An invoice can have many products and a product can appear in many invoices. That way, invoices and products, subjects, they have got many-to-many relation. It is clear, but one-to-many relation is easier for a relational database to define, but many-to-many is not a one-step process. We end up creating an intermediate table, which means that we add another type of table in this whole environment. It is called a line item table, which will have a one-to-many relation with the invoices table and a one-to-many relation with the products table. Okay, now the relations which look like are a customer can have many invoices, which was same as the previous relation, one-to-many. Invoices can have many line items, one to many, and products can have can be part of many line items. So it is a one to many relation also between products and line items. Next step is to identify the various attributes of the fields. This is the time when we define the subject in general, in details, and talk about the various fields that can represent the subject. For example, in case of customer table, we define a few fields, customer ID, customer name, address, phone, order date. Similarly for rest of the tables also. And the next step, once now we have defined the attributes, we define the keys. The definition of defining of the keys means we are trying to identify the primary and the foreign keys. for creation of the relation. And then basically this will decide how the data is stored, how the data relates to one another. The two tables, customer table and invoice table, we define our primary keys as customer ID. In the second table, we define the primary key as invoice ID. Now in these two tables, we have identified the primary keys which can uniquely identify this particular table, each row in this table. We talk about a foreign key. In this invoices table, the customer ID will serve as the foreign key, which is referenced from the customers table. Likewise, for the whole set of tables, we will define these foreign keys and primary keys. Another thing to consider over here is that if at any point of time we realize that we are not able to identify any relation of a certain table with the rest of the tables, that means that particular relation or a table doesn't exist, should not exist in this database. One example would be, in this example, let's say we were trying to identify the customer invoice database. We were trying to create the customer invoice database, and we came up with three subjects: customer, invoices, and products. We could have come up with another subject, let's say employees, because employees are also part of the organization. Now, but the employees table may or may not have a relation with any of these tables. So if that table doesn't, at any step, we realize that this table we are not able to relate to or have no relation with any other tables, we will keep that table out of the database. So that means that employee table will not belong to this particular database. Another thing to consider at this step, at the creation of the key step, is to remove the initial redundancies. That means any field which can be referenced or can be made available from a different table must be removed from a certain table. One example of this would be the salesperson field. If you see salesperson, for a customer ID, if you're trying to create a customer table, we always won't be having a salesperson, same salesperson for the same customer. It might be a different salesperson at different times. That way, we end up creating different rows in the customer table for the same customer ID, which is not as per the properties of the relational database, that it should have only unique values in the primary keys. And this second thing is the atomicity. At the same time, we cannot put multiple salesperson names in the same similar in a single row. That way we end up using the second table, invoice table. An invoice will always have a single salesperson, and each row will be having a single atomic value. We will keep the salesperson field in the invoice table, but we will remove it from the customer table. But later on, if someone wants to query that for a certain invoice, for that customer ID, who was a salesperson, the question can still be asked. We don't have to store the data at two different places. And once these kind of keys and redundancies are removed, keys identified and redundancies are removed, we have a functional database, but which might not be up to mark or optimized as per the guidelines of the relational data model. So that is where the normalization comes into the picture. We can either add more tables or split a single table into multiple tables based on the normal form that we're taking, and or may end up adding more columns into the table as part of normalization. So these are the steps that are involved in planning a relational database model. Now the question arises, when to use a relational data model? Okay, before going forward, were the steps clear? If you have any queries.
Yeah, I'm good, sir.
All right. So next, we talk about when to use a relational data model. What are the situations when a relational model would be of use? The very first one is when the data integrity is of absolute importance. That means if a certain application wants the data, the reference data, to be related in a way that it complies with the ACID properties, then we will end up using a relational database. If the data itself is highly structured, it is advisable to use a relational database. If automation of the internal process is needed, then we should use relational database. Why we use a relational database in case of automation? There is a concept called as cascading. Okay, cascading is like the problem that I discussed previously was that in the normalization case was that if we cannot delete a row from a referencing table or from a reference table if it is being referenced somewhere. For this kind of thing, there is something called as cascading. Okay, we call there are different types of cascading. One example I'll take, we'll say update on a cascade on update. Let's say if there is an update happening in a table, which is the reference table in which the different primary keys are present. Think of that example in which we have got the course IDs. They are the primary keys in the reference table. And now we want to update. According to the anomaly, this system will not allow a certain entry which is referenced, which is being used somewhere else in the table. Let's say we are trying to update the ID 2, which is being referenced in another table as a foreign key. The relational data models provide the cascading abilities which make the system work in a way that if the update request comes for the reference table for that value 2 and it is being referenced at any other table as the foreign key, the system will automatically update the referencing table. So how these are done depends upon what technology we are using, what kind of database feature that is available with the database. But the logic that is used to do this kind of thing is called as cascading. And because all these kind of things are available in relational data model, automation can be there. Next one is applications which are heavy into analysis. That would require a huge base level to have all the transactions available. In that case, we use a relational data model. If we end up using different joins, let's say data is being sourced from two different sources, but they can relate to each other, we might create two different tables and relate them through some keys. And eventually, queries which need the two tables to be joined can be answered. These kind of requirements are there. Then a data model, a relational data model would be of good use. And eventually, the apps that require tiered access. This means the authorization part. We don't want to provide access to a certain group of users to a certain table. These kind of things are managed very well by the relational data models. So that kind of, in that kind of case, a relational data model will be of good use. And lastly, I'm going to talk about a few advantages and disadvantages of a relational data model. Firstly, the advantages. Accuracy. There is no duplication in this. I mean, we try to, with all the normalization and all, we try to remove all the redundancy. That way, there won't be a minimal duplication in the whole relational database. So the database results would be accurate. Simplicity. The way of arranging data in the form of tables for structured data is more intuitive. Third is ease of data retrieval. There is no rigid pathway to follow like in hierarchical data models. But over here, because it's relations, everything is taken care by the simple SQL queries. The user doesn't need to know what goes underneath. Data integrity. Because relational data models are ACID compliant, the integrity is maintained. Data integrity prevents data to become incomplete or orphaned, because if, let's say, data is a certain record is deleted whose primary key was present somewhere else, the database will not allow such kind of thing. So because of that, let's say if a primary key is deleted and the record that was referenced is still present, these sort of things are not should not be allowed in a relational data model. There is a way in which we can reference this thing in a better way. So that way the integrity is maintained. Next is flexibility. Complex queries are easy to carry out. And normalization, like we discussed. Collaboration, multiple users can work on a certain set of table at the same time. And authorization or security, the same thing. The relational data models provide need-based permission to different tables and relations as and when needed. So these are a few of the advantages. Now let's move on to some disadvantages which led to the creation of new world databases. First one is the cost. They tend to be more expensive. Cost is a consideration when creating or setting up a relational database. Scaling, the structure of relational databases, basically it makes it difficult for the scaling to happen. It's not that it is not possible, but it's not that intuitive. Sharding in relational databases is very important, but it is very difficult to manage while maintaining the ACID compliance. Next important one is the unstructured data. The fixed schema that the data model topic we were discussing about schema on write and schema on read. The schema on write is what is followed in the relational data model. That means the structure, the data would be structured while writing it. And any changes happening to that structure will lead to big changes in the entire system. So unstructured data might not be very easily maintained by relational data models. At the same time, complex real world things like an image or let's say any blob of data, it's quite difficult for the relational data models to take care of it. And the last one is isolated databases. Like I said, in the example of while we were trying to plan a relational database, that if a certain table doesn't belong or is not related to any other table in the whole database, then we will not keep this table inside the database. That way, for a big organizations, if there are business units which do not talk to each other, we will end up creating small databases for each one of them, which do not talk to each other. That is like islands of information created with because of the complexity that we have in relational databases. So these are the disadvantages of relational data models. And that's all. Thank you.
Very good. Comprehensive. Any questions? Okay, then I will stop recording here.